Hello, my name is Steven. Welcome to Hyfindr Tech Talks, where we aim to understand the technology that makes the hydrogen economy work. Today, I am particularly excited because today we are going to talk about hydrogen refueling. Yes, I know it's a huge topic, but we have someone from Wolftank here today, a company that has done over 100 automations in this field all around the world. And there we have Gernot Mariacher, who has led up the setup of hydrogen refueling stations in several instances, and it's my particular pleasure to have Gernot right here in the studio. Welcome, Gernot Mariacher.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Stephen, for the introduction. I'm glad to be here and discussing with you.
Perfect, Gernot. It's a pleasure. To kick things off, what is hydrogen refueling?
Hydrogen refueling is basically the process getting the hydrogen into the vehicle for usage in the mobility, getting started with the vehicle.
Okay, so getting into the vehicle. So what do you need to make this work?
Well, I have a sketch here can have a look on. Mm-hmm. So basically you have the hydrogen supply, whether from a logistic container, electrolyzer, and then a compressor unit, a storage, a chilling unit, and then the dispenser who takes care that the hydrogen goes into the vehicle in a controlled manner.
So this is what a typical setup looks like. This is for a stationary or a mobile application, or this is just very general?
This is very in general, yeah.
Okay. So can you take us deeper? So we see on the diagram like the different things that play together, but how does this exactly work? I'm really burning to know this.
Well, there is a big difference to other refueling processes like diesel or gas, because hydrogen behavior is an expansion into the vehicle. It heats up, and there you have a type 4 cylinders, which are made of carbon fibers for terms of the weight, having a low weight, and they have a temperature limit at about 85 degrees, and then due to the low density of the hydrogen, you have to compress it on a very high pressure to have the correct or suitable amount of hydrogen with you for the usage in the mobility. Yeah.
Okay. So essentially, you have to optimize the insertion of the hydrogen to match a certain temperature. And I see you have a diagram for that as well.
Yeah, so the refueling is always the target is a density. So you see here, we are talking always about the 350 and 700 bar pressure levels. These are mainly the pressure levels at 15 degrees Celsius. If you are on minus 40 or on 85, the pressure inside the vehicle is also different.
Ah, okay. So that means at 15 degrees, you actually have the 350 or the 700 bar. But if the ambient temperature of the vehicle goes down, the pressure drops. And if you go park the car in the desert, the pressure in the tank gets higher.
Gets higher, yeah. And then you have the maximum pressure, where you have the overpressure. This is where the tanks in the vehicle are certified for, and also the maximum temperature.
Okay.
Due to the expansion in the vehicle, the hydrogen heats up, and so it's also very important to not reach this 85 degrees.
So that means essentially when we are refueling, we never want to go into a zone where if the vehicle later goes into a higher temperature area, the pressure goes higher than 875 bar, nor do we want to allow the temperature inside the tank to go higher than 85 degrees because of the refueling. Is this correct?
This is correct. This risk mainly exists on a high speed of refueling or short refueling time, because if you have the expansion from a low pressure to in a very short time, the gained heat is more risky for the vehicle tank.
So we have learned actually also in other tech talks that as you insert hydrogen into the tank, you know, it gets hot.
Yeah.
And so essentially in the whole refueling process, that's what we're trying to manage. And also as we see here on this very interesting diagram, you know, as you put the hydrogen in such a way that even if the tank would get hot later, it would never exceed this overpressure ratio. Yep. So meaning that if you were filling up the vehicle at, say, 0 degrees, which could be winter temperature, you would not fill it up to 700 bar. You would fill it up to, what would it, like 650 bar, or what would it be?
Roughly, I would say about 650,
650, okay, so there you go.
So then in summertime, at currently 30 degrees outside, you're in the range of up to close to 800 bars. as well, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So when it's 30 degrees, like in summertime, you actually fill to almost 800 bar.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, interesting.
Because basically the filling is the state of charge, like it's mentioned here,
yeah.
is the density. So you have the density at this point, at the 700 bar, it's about 40 grams per kilogram.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
this is the density where you're following and which is always here. So on a higher temperature, you will have a higher pressure.
Okay, wow. Okay.
Still the same density.
So that's already the first level of complexity that we are mastering here when it comes to refilling hydrogen. Okay. Can you take us a little bit further?
Of course, yeah. So let's go ahead. Mm-hmm. This is a basic sketch of a hydrogen refueling station.
Yes.
We have here the vehicle yeah. with the tank inside. There's a check valve there, so that the fueled hydrogen cannot escape.
Yes.
Then you connect here with the nozzle
yes.
to the car, so the nozzle is then locked.
Let me see if we can actually zoom that in. Wait just a second. Okay, that doesn't work. We can do it like that. Okay, mm-hmm. but essentially this is the nozzle.
The nozzle, yeah.
That gets connected to the car. Okay, and we see here what is this?
This is a infrared board.
Data connection. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Data connection. So the vehicles they have an infrared board, and mm-hmm. this part is actually integrated into the nozzle.
Okay.
So the nozzle has this infrared receiver.
Yeah.
Inside and. Gives them feedback to the station about the temperature and the pressure of the tank.
Okay, so this is the flow of hydrogen. Maybe you can take us along this journey, sort of. Mm-hmm.
So once connected here,
yeah.
you push the start button and then mm-hmm. refueling will start. I think mm-hmm. we jump to the next one.
Yeah.
So you see here we have the pressure vessels. So these are additional pressure with say 500 bar, for example. So hydrogen flows here. Passes a filter, then we have here the control valve, and then we have here the heat exchanger.
The cooling.
The cooling.
Yeah.
Down the chiller.
We have another video on cooling, actually. I think that's good. Yeah, that's
And to chill down the hydrogen, a flow meter to measure the flow,
yes.
the mass flow of the hydrogen. Then we have here several pressure transducers and temperature transducers, and then hydrogen flows here. This is a breakaway couple mm-hmm. in case the car would escape or would roll out of the station, this breaks off.
This one.
And closes immediately so that it shuts off immediately so that nothing is happening at the station at all.
Yes.
And then hydrogen flows inside the vehicle tank.
Okay, I just need to ask that again. So actually, at the hydrogen refueling station for vehicles, you have a special mechanism that if the thing is connected to the car, putting in pressure of pressurized hydrogen, and the driver, whoever that maybe decides to drive off with the thing stuck in, there is a brake mechanism that it can... Where is that? Is that at the nozzle directly or is that somewhere near the dispenser?
At the end of the hose.
Okay, at the end of the hose. So you can actually take the hose and then go on the highway and continue driving.
Yeah.
And safe, nothing happens. Okay.
That's safe, nothing happens because there is the check valve on the vehicle and well, depends how much you have fueled, you can drive.
Then at some point you realize that I'm dragging something behind. Okay, all right. Okay, so that is okay. Sorry, I just dobbed in there.
At a certain time, pressure or the pressure difference is too small so that the flow is going down.
Mm-hmm.
So then you need to switch to another pressure tank.
To
the second one.
Yes.
This, for example, is on 900 bars.
Yes. This is the cascading.
The cascading, okay.
Yeah. I need to mention we have another video on cascading. Super interesting as well. But yeah, so we're breaking down the process. You covering the whole thing. This is beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so yes, please go on.
So then we're switching to the other pressure bank, and then hydrogen flows again from here and fills up to the state of charge. Goal is greater than 95%.
Okay, and that's depending on the graph we saw before. How much it eventually gets them put
mm-hmm.
in. Okay, and I see you have this data connection. What is happening there? Why do you need that?
Data connection gives feedback, or initially gives because it's also very important for the refueling to have the initial state of the hydrogen tank, to have the size, they have the temperature and the pressure inside.
Yeah.
Because according to this, then the hydrogen flow is, or the protocol is chosen, or the the speed of refueling.
So that's so the station has quite a bit of intelligence to manage all that. I think that's where also you specialize in. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
Well, this is very very generic here. Mm-hmm. And next step then will be the car is full, next car will come, and then the compressor is filling up the on-site storages.
Yeah. Ah, okay. So the compressor essentially has the job to fill the storage, which when the vehicle shows up is kind of like released into that, and that's allowed the speed. Yeah. And then we learned in the other video that because of this fast release, you actually need to cool it there. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool.
But one topic is, well, this is a very generic sketch of the hydrogen refueling station. So it depends on the size of station, whether you want to refuel passenger vehicles or trucks at 350 bars or with higher amounts. You have to choose the right size of the storages on site, because also the back-to-back. So when one car is out, you will need some time to fill up the storage. So in case you want to fill five cars in a row, you have to choose initially larger storages.
Okay.
That's one of the big differences to a diesel fueling process, because on a diesel station you're getting the diesel out of a thousands of liter tank and can refuel
as much as there is subsequently.
And
here you have to,
here
like,
have to manage the station.
Okay, cool. I think what's also very interesting is you have a certain curve that you use for the frame. Maybe you can tell us about that. I saw that in the preparation now. It was like totally exciting.
Well, this is a sketch about the refueling process in general. So this is the point where you connect the nozzle to the vehicle, then you push the start button, then you have a pressure.
So this is actually a refueling process as it happens over time.
Over time, yeah.
So here we see the pressure on the one side, and this is the point where the vehicle is already connected, the hose is in, and then the person refueling, he or she, presses the start button.
Then there is the hose is pressurized, so there's a pressure surge. Yeah. So you hear the connection pulse, and then there is a leak check ongoing. And during this leak check, the station is measuring if the connection between the station and the vehicle is good, and there are no leaks.
Yeah.
This is in a time frame of a couple of seconds.
Okay.
And then afterwards, this small pressure surge is for detection of the vehicle size or the tank size if it's not not transmitted by the infrared. And then the refueling initially starts at this point. So this is the pre-fueling process.
How long does this first part take?
It's a couple of seconds, 10 to 20 seconds.
10 to 20 seconds, okay. So at the beginning you're doing check that the connection is fine, and also actually this is very interesting, with the just putting pressure on the pipe and measuring what happens then with the mass flow, so you can actually determine the size of the tank of the vehicle, which I found that very interesting. And then you go on to ride this curve.
Yeah, and then the yellow curve is then the temperature inside the vehicle tank, and then to manage not exceeding the 85 degrees or staying still on the safe side below, you have to control the flow rate or the pressure increase more or less in the vehicle side in the vehicle tank. So this is then that the hydrogen is flowing in a manner that the average pressure ramp rate is in within this pressure corridor and this boundary conditions. And this is all. Well, currently there are many protocols from the SAE standard, the Society of Automotive Engineers, and there is also the Clean Energy Partnership having protocols for a cooled and uncooled refueling. These are the main standards currently, and these are safe standards to have a fast and reliable and safe refueling process.
So with the SAE, I think it's J2601 that we currently have, you get essentially this flow from the protocol. This is what they outline and say you must do it in this way.
Yeah. So
they say. Yeah. And then you go on to ride, you know, to fill, and then you do a leak check again.
Well, here this is the point where we have seen before where the pressure equals in the storage tank and the vehicle tank, and then where you have to change to the next bank.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, and that is the cascading. Again, I think if we explain cascading is a lot to explain. We have another video about that. But
And in between this, there is another leak check, or it's possible to do another leak check in this one.
Okay. So there, and then you go on to the next tank system, and then you go on to the next storage tank system until you reach the end, and you're monitoring the temperature all the time. Okay, so we've mentioned JAE. What is? I've also heard high flow and standard flow. What does that mean?
Well, currently, there are more standard flow is the equipment allows up to, or the also the protocols up to 60 grams per second.
Yes, this
is the standard flow. There are protocols in development for higher flow rates up to 120 and even higher, because for future developments, they are looking for heavy duty, long distance or long haul trucks and ships and trains, which really need a high amount of hydrogen to shorten the refueling time. Another topic to shorten the refueling time is to chill down the hydrogen.
In the storage already?
No, before dispensing.
We saw this in your graph. The more we chill here, the faster we.
Yeah. Can. So the protocols and standardized chilling temperatures at T20 and T40 are the most famous or most common ones.
Yeah, minus 40 degrees.
Minus 40 degrees and minus 20 degrees. So you chill down the hydrogen, so you avoid that when the curve is going up. Yeah. To reach the 85 degrees.
But if I chilled more, I could feel faster. Is this correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Okay, but probably that cost me more energy to do
it. Costs more energy.
And speaking of cost, again, I need to ask you about this. So when we look at all these things in the setup of a refueling station, I mean, I hear $1 million as a cost. What is it that is driving the cost here? What is so expensive in a refueling station?
Well, it's not only components here.
Okay, we need to look at the bigger picture. Is that?
Yeah,
this one.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe also on this one.
Yeah, this is a real picture.
This is a real picture. So this is a fueling station. You have a lot of different things. You have ramp protection. You have also safety, safety auxiliaries like gas detectors and safety systems on site, and sprinklers in some cases, or this. In, for example, this is a station in Italy where you need explosion-proof walls at the storage, and so on. So there is quite a lot of complexity, and I think also the factor of scale is not even there.
Okay. But what is the most expensive part of a hydrogen refueling station?
Most expensive parts, I guess, currently are compressors. Yeah.
Compressors. Okay. Yeah. So the compressor sitting there, and I mean, and I guess all this explosion protection and so on, that kind of adds up.
Yeah.
So what can we do to make it less expensive?
That's a good question.
Yeah. Okay.
That's for me. But I think it's compressors and storage. So I think storage is going something with the scale factor, having more storages on site. I think also in compressor side, and I think there will also be some standardizations in station design.
So you know, with that is already a bit of an outlook. Yeah. So how do you see refueling developing in the next 10, 20 years? I mean, you have to consider the iPhone is only 15 years old and see what we've seen. So 10, 20 years of refueling.
Well, it's a very long range.
Yeah.
Definitely. But currently, the prospect for future is the focus is more on the higher pressures. I think then when the higher amounts of vehicle fleets are rising, currently it's a little bit a lack of vehicles on the road, so the stations are quite small and also in performance more, so performance will grow definitely. And then I think also the supply chain behind will change.
Will change, okay. Yeah, and I mean, with that, of course, I think prices will go down and that will help.
Hopefully, yeah.
Gernot, it's amazing. Unfortunately, we've come to the end of the time, but we have somehow managed to ride through the whole refueling process. Thanks to you. It has been an absolute pleasure talking to you about this, Gernot. And I hope that you enjoyed the video. If you do, please leave us a comment here or subscribe to the channel. On Hyfindr, you can find people like Gernot and companies that make the hydrogen economy work. So go to hyfindr.com to take a look at all of that and get in contact with them. You can also find the community there and many things that will make the hydrogen economy grow. Please also feel free to watch another video if you like. Thank you very much for taking the time to watch this one. And thank you, Gernot, for coming.
Thank you for
your time. Have a wonderful day. Goodbye.
Goodbye.